Welcome to this next module, which is on empathy. So we've done awareness, balance, clarity, deliberate action, and you might be wondering why empathy is one of the five core areas we've selected to be empowered despite circumstance. And with us today is an expert in empathy, Daniel Schmachtenberger, who is a real expert in this area. And he has such a unique background in the social sciences and sociology, in personal growth, as well as in the science of cognitive behavioral therapy and the cognitive sciences. And so it's a real pleasure to have Daniel here guiding us on this journey of empathy and helping us better understand how critical empathy is in being empowered despite circumstance. Before we dive in, I want to share a little bit about Daniel's story and what's led him here. And so Daniel is a true visionary. And among the group of friends and colleagues we associate with, Daniel will be introduced as one of the smartest guys I know. And consistently, and that's how I like to introduce Daniel as well. He's really a brilliant guy and has been working on global issues. So he's the founder of Critical Path Global, which is a think tank focused on really solving some of the world's hardest problems. And through that process, Daniel's arrived at empathy being one of the critical pieces to solving many of these global problems and getting into the core values of humanity, right? And so to kick things off, Daniel, I'd love to hear your perspective on why empathy and why you feel it's so important.
Thanks for having me, Andrew. What empathy is first, and then we can get into why it's so important. Empathy is often described as the ability to take another person's perspective, the ability to feel what another person's feeling, sometimes described as vicariously experiencing someone else's experience. And so that has to do with both caring about somebody else and about getting it, both of which are really critical, right? Sometimes there's a distinction made between empathy, sympathy, and compassion, which are all very related. And I'm not going to make that distinction right now because it's not done in a universal way. Those words are used in different ways, you know, by different groups teaching it. And so I'm just going to talk to the positive function that they all collectively represent, which is the ability to put ourselves in another person's perspective, to sense what's going on with them, to be able to feel into what it would feel like, what the underlying needs would be, and then to be able to actually communicate the sensing of what you're getting so that they can feel heard, feel seen, feel gotten. That allows you both to know what an appropriate response would be. And so often, if someone is feeling something and you don't have any particular thing you can do to help, any particular solution, just empathy by itself, just expressing that you really feel what's going on for them and you get it, offers a healing for them. Because it offers a healing from feeling separate, from them feeling alone, like maybe nobody gets what's going on. And sometimes without anything else to offer, without any solution, that by itself creates a space in them where they're like, ah, somebody gets what's going on for me, somebody cares, and there's a healing that starts to occur for them there.
So would you say empathy is like a sense, like feeling or hearing? And if that's the case, are some people just better at it than others?
I would say empathy is fundamentally different than what we typically call senses. When we think about our five senses, seeing, hearing, tasting, you can't avoid that, right? If something's coming into your field of vision, you don't have to actively try to do anything to see it, and you can't even really get away from it, right? It's basically a hardwired physiological capacity. Empathy is something different than that. When I say I feel what's going on with you, I empathize with what's going on with you, I'm not actually feeling what's going on with you, I'm not feeling it as a sense. What's happening is I'm imagining it, right? It's a projection of experience, which requires me thinking about what's going on for you, thinking about your past and your position well enough that I really get some depth and some detail, and trying to draw on similar related experiences that I've had so that I can be like, oh, what did it feel like when I was going through that loss or hardship or whatever it is, or when I can empathize with that too. And so what's so interesting about empathy is that it requires our thinking and our feeling both. It requires thinking into ourself and thinking in our own experience and thinking into the other person, right? And it requires really listening to what they say, listening to not just what they say, but what else you're hearing behind what they say, listening to the underlying needs, the underlying feelings and motives. So empathy really utilizes our entire human capacity. And so as you're practicing really empathizing with someone else, you're practicing a very whole brain, whole being experience. And that's why some people can seem better at it than others, is because it's really a developed capacity. And some people's lives have helped them develop that. They had parents that were naturally good at it. They had teachers or inclinations. And other people haven't learned it as much. And the cool thing is, it is developable. It really is one of the main criteria of emotional intelligence. And something that anybody can practice at.
That's a great perspective. When I think of people who are empathetic, I often think of people like my mom, who are very loving and caring and have got into their heart, and they really lead with their heart. What I'm hearing you say is it's actually beyond that. It's a full spectrum. And you're right, it includes a cognitive ability as well, right? It's the ability to imagine what that person's experiencing.
Yeah.
And so I really like this idea of building this full spectrum of empathic capacity, right?
Yeah.
And integrating that.
Have you ever had an experience with your mom or anyone else that you would fit in that category where you knew that they really cared about you and you also felt not gotten?
Yeah, totally.
And so the kind of support they were offering felt like, hey, maybe you really don't give the benefit of the doubt that I'm capable, or maybe you don't really know what I'm going through. So even though they're caring and that feels good, you also feel missed in a way.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, you feel the love.
Yeah.
But you're also a little frustrated because they don't get it.
And so the full picture of empathy that we're really interested in is a sense that someone really gets what's going on for you as best they can, that they're like, wow, I really get why you're doing exactly what you're doing, and that if I was in your shoes, I'd be doing the same thing, and I get what you need, and I care.
Mm.
Right?
Right. Which is where awareness comes in. Right, in practicing cultivating awareness and understanding the ripple and desires, energy, emotions, behaviors, and when we get good at that ourselves, it helps us be able to understand what others are going through, right?
Yeah, the more aware we are of our own experience, hey, when I'm feeling something, what am I usually needing that's not happening underneath that? What are the stories and I'm maybe telling myself and the meanings that are happening, is I have more insight into my own process than my ability to empathize with someone else has a lot more depth to it, right?
Right. So here's a question. So when you're empathizing with somebody, does that mean you think they're right?
Mm-hmm, good question. Empathy doesn't mean that you think their perspective is objectively true. It means that you get their perspective, right? That you get, oh wow, seeing it from where they're coming from, I can totally see that there is a partial rightness. There's a partial truth to where they're coming from. They're not just crazy, right? Even if there's some data that they're missing, even if there's some data they have that's distorted, hey, if that was the data I was operating on, I'd be feeling what they were feeling. I'd be behaving the way they were behaving, right? And I really care, and I get that deeper than their perspective, whether they're right or wrong, that there are underlying needs that are real, right? So maybe their perspective isn't wholly true. There's some data that's missing or distorted, but what they're needing that feels like it's not being met, you can say, wow, I totally get that you need that. I care about that. And then you can say, well, there's some truth to their perspective, even if there's some stuff missing, and maybe there's some truth to their perspective that was missing from my perspective before, right? And so maybe neither of our perspectives are right. Maybe they're both partial. And maybe a perspective is by definition always partial.
Mm.
That's what it means, right? You're looking at the building from the west side, and someone else is from the east side, and you describe what you see, and there's a conflict, and who's right? Well, they're both partially right.
Mm.
What does the whole building look like? There's not one snapshot that gives you that. It's the ability to move into different perspectives that allows you to see the whole thing, not any perspective by itself.
So what I'm hearing you say, a big part of empathy is understanding this concept of perspective and really building that muscle to be able to see from other perspectives rather than being certain about your own perspective or even certain about what you think their perspective is.
Totally. There are a couple key things that you said in there. The ability to take another perspective isn't something that our perspective does. right? Perspective is kind of synonymous with ego. Hey, my perspective is this, yours is that, this is the basis for us to have conflict, right? But my ability to take your perspective isn't what my, it's not my perspective anymore. I left mine. I left what I think is true to be able to come into yours. If I didn't, I didn't empathize that well. I'd say, yeah, I kind of get what they're coming from, but they're still stupid. If I've really empathized and I'm like, wow, I so get it, in their shoes, I'd be doing the exact same thing. Mm-hmm. Seeing it the way they see it, going through what they went through. And if I don't feel that yet, then I still have some judgment on them. That's antithetical to real empathy, to real compassion. And it means that we believe we're fundamentally superior to them and we're not, right? And so we can say, wow, I want to offer them things that will add perspective for them, that will enrich their perspective. But when we leave our perspective to take someone else's, we become bigger because we recognize that we aren't just our perspective, we're the capacity to take any perspective. And that's why the practice of empathy, besides making relationships work better, is one of the most powerful personal growth, and you could call it spiritual growth things that someone can do, because if you want to call the capacity to take any perspective, you can call that kind of higher self or consciousness or awareness itself, right? Awareness independent of the particular perspective it's looking through. And in order to really empathize with someone, you have to step out of your own perspective into that capacity. You know, the Dalai Lama has this really beautiful, brilliant saying that you can either be kind or you can be right, but not both. And it doesn't mean that being kind means you're wrong, but if you're seeking to be right in a dichotomous right-wrong dynamic, you're also seeking to make someone else wrong, which is not commensurate with kindness. And so he says you can be kind or you can be right, but not both. And you can be kind or happy, but not both, because if you do the right thing, right-wrong game, you're going to be in conflict. Personal relationships are going to suffer. And whether you feel like you won or not, you're still alone. But kind and happy go together really well, right? And so part of empathy is recognizing that connection matters more than content, right? So if I'm focused on being right about a particular topic with you, and I think you're wrong and this topic is so important, and I'm willing to fight you over it, I'm willing to harm the connection between us for some particular piece of content. Mm-hmm. I've made the content matter more than connecting to you. Right? But our ability to do anything together, my ability to get this idea across or any other idea at any time, depends on our connection. And so if I'm willing to harm the connection between us for some particular piece of content, not only will I lose here, but I'll lose everywhere else. Mm. And so part of the emotional intelligence connected to empathy is recognizing that the feeling state of other people and your connection to them matters more than any content, because the content has to travel across that connection. And so you always want to nourish that connection as the basis for any content moving.
So an empathy ninja would be one who approaches situations in relations with others with this idea that that connection is priority number one.
Yeah.
Interesting.
And even if you really care about this idea and you want to influence them or having them change their perspective, what's the chance that you're going to succeed if they feel attacked by you and defensive? Versus they feel understood by you, cared about, and safe enough to open, and then they want to hear what you have to say.
Mm, that's great.
So another part of empathy, it's this two-way thing. It's sensing into where they're coming from. So really hearing them without just hearing that they're wrong and dumb, right? But really hearing where they're coming from, feeling it, and then being able to communicate that back so they know that we get it. And then also being able to communicate what we want to share with them, feeling into how they're going to receive it. And so there's this idea that I want to communicate in a way that doesn't elicit their defensiveness, but that elicits and engenders their interest and their empathy. Part of empathy is also being able to invoke empathy from others. Mm-hmm. Because if I really feel into how you're going to receive what I share, I'm going to share a lot more effectively. So empathy is both directions in communication.
Yeah, well said. So Daniel, does empathizing with somebody mean that you're sacrificing your perspective and that you're giving up what you believed in order to understand them?
Only temporarily. It doesn't mean that you're acknowledging your perspective as wrong or invalid, and it doesn't even mean that you're going to act in any particular way necessarily different than you would have before understanding them. It means that you're willing to put your perspective on hold for a minute to really hear theirs, and then being able to factor both or all, then you get to assess what really do I see as true here, and how do I want to act factoring all of that? And it may be that what you had originally held, you still hold, but you hold it with more awareness of how it affects the other people, maybe more softness, right? And it may be that your original perspective was missing some things. And so it's not about sacrificing your own perspective, it's about just letting go of being completely identified with it for a moment. And what you identify with instead is the care for the highest good of all, the care to really be connected to what's true, right? The capacity to take any perspective. And then as you've taken the other person's perspective or all the people's perspective, now you have a meta perspective, right? Now you aren't the identity that's in this limited perspective. You're the consciousness or the awareness that can hold all of them and care about all of them. And now you get to decide, how do I want to act and how do I want to position myself and hold truth factoring all of this. So you aren't sacrificing your perspective at all. You're going to add to it. You're just going to put it on hold for a moment.
So it's almost like you become the referee in a sporting event where you move out of your player position, become that referee, and you're seeing all the perspectives, and your role is to be objective and to do what's right.
That's one way of looking at it. And that you kind of switch being in potential competition, conflict with the other person to actually the referee saying, hey, y'all are on the same team and you forgot that.
Mm-hmm. So Daniel, you're obviously somebody who's focused on major global issues. And in doing that, you know, you've identified there's no shortage of really important things to be tackling right now. And so how do you feel empathy? Feel empathy for the voiceless, the animals, the trees that are being chopped down or going extinct, or for people that don't have a voice, social injustice. How do you feel the weight of that empathy without it disempowering you, without feeling bad because of it? How do you stay empowered with empathy?
I think it's one of the deepest questions any conscious person is going to ask. And I think it's an ongoing balance, which is, how can I have my heart as open as possible to really feel the pains, the pleasures of other people and other life forms, to really care and not be hardened, and at the same time to feel really empowered in my own personal life and not crushed by the weight of the collective suffering that I don't necessarily know how to do anything about in this moment? And how do I take all of that suffering and all of my care for it and then harness that into something useful? And a couple insights that I'll share, and I'll share that this is an ongoing wrestling match for me and every really conscious person I know. So it's not like a simple and then you're done kind of answer. Is the only reason that seeing the pain of another hurts is because you care. Right, so whenever you're empathizing and you're feeling the pain of what's happening to people in a war-torn area, to starving kids, to animals in a laboratory or a factory farm, and you hurt, if you didn't care about them at all, it wouldn't hurt. And so underneath the hurt really is love, and so you want to feel it, and then you want to come back to underneath that is love, and then you want to come back to, hey, I'm feeling this for a purpose, which is to see how I can guide my life to be of more use to the greater good. And so the couple keys are connecting that experience of suffering back to the experience of love, and then the experience of the ability to be useful to it. And you're not going to be able to be useful to all of it, but that's why there's 7 billion of us that all have different callings, right? And so you can feel the pain of all of it, and then you got to come back to, so what is mine to heal? What's mine to solve? And your passion, your dharma will be solving part of it, right? And then be able to channel all of that feeling into how you show up in with passion.
Mm.
You know, and there's one other part that's really important is, if we get really involved in activism, in caring about the rest of life and collective life, then it can be easy to focus on the suffering and wanting to feel it and wanting to be able to do something about it, in exclusion of focusing on the beauty in life as well, and that's a mistake. And so in activism, there's the saying that if you're not outraged, if you're not heartbroken, you're not paying attention. And it's true, because if you know what's happening in any war-torn area around the world, if you know what's happening with child soldiers, or you know what's happening with coral reefs dying off, or like, you're heartbroken, and you should be. And if you're not, you're not paying attention, or you're deadened inside, right? You need to allow yourself to feel again. But the mystic and the artist say, if you're not overwhelmed with awe at the beauty of existence, you're not paying attention. And that's equally true, and you got to hold both of those, that reality is overwhelmingly beautiful and there's tremendous pain in it. And how do you hold both of those? And so the keys to feeling the pain and not being burdened by it is feeling it in balance with the beauty, and then connecting that pain back to the love and back to the empowered possibility for you to act and make a difference.
And if we look at, you know, game changers throughout history, people who have felt that weight of the world, got clear on what was theirs to heal and acted on it, and the joy and the life that they led with, like, look at Nelson Mandela, right, who, despite really challenging circumstances, his empathy actually led him through that. It was his love that fulfilled him and allowed him to really fulfill his mission. And so I think there's something to be said around feeling that pain also plugs you into your purpose. And that feels great. That feels like waking up every day and being on a mission.
Exactly. What bothers you in the world the most? What hurts the most when you see it? And what lights you up the most, what you feel the most joy around, are both key indicators to your purpose.
So version two is all about this next phase of the human endeavor, this version two of humanity, upgrading to a better version of ourselves. And so why is empathy, in your opinion, one of the core pillars for upgrading the human species to a better force on this planet?
There's a lot of ways we're empathizing with others personally, and then even abstractly as a whole species or a whole planet, is really directly beneficial to us as individuals. One of the first things is, empathy is a really powerful way to heal our narcissism, right? When you really get into someone else's perspective, you get out of your perspective being the only way to see the world. And when you really feel the collective challenges and struggles in the world, then it doesn't mean that you neglect your own and you lose empathy for self. Empathy for self is part of it. It just takes context where you aren't the center of the whole universe anymore, right? You're an integrated part of it, and you care about your experience and your wants and your challenges, and you care about those for others and for collectively larger set of others as you keep being able to expand your circle of care. And so the narcissism of being this tiny center of the universe actually gets healed through that empathy. That's one huge element of it. And it actually means some of our own hurt bothers us less. Doesn't mean we feel less connected to it, but it's less all-consuming, right? Another element is that we said empathy is about not just caring about, but also getting someone else's perspective. So there's this cognitive element of the ability to take other perspectives. This is actually a cognitive capacity, right? That not just being able to see through someone else's eyes is good for the interpersonal relationship, but it also means you're going to see things about the world you didn't see before. It's going to make you more astute, more flexible in your perceptions, more aware. In business, that means you're going to, if you take on multiple people's perspectives, hey, you know, from a user experience point of view, what does this look like? Mm-hmm. From, you know, a customer advocate point of view, from the point of view of this particular kind of person, it's actually going to give you huge insights into how to be creative, into how to problem solve. And then even deeper than that is that your identity expands radically to not being this thing that is in conflict with and in disagreement with other people, because when you're just your perspective, there's a lot of people that are fundamentally in conflict with you. But when you're the capacity to take your perspective and theirs, then there's nobody who's fundamentally in conflict with you and nobody that you can't relate with. And so empathy is huge for our own personal development and huge for our interpersonal development. And when we look at all the pains in the world, if our empathy was tuned up, whatever we were doing that contributed to causing those pains would be something we would have to take more responsibility for and not do if we really got the effects more and we cared more.
Yeah. So final question, Daniel. Empowered despite circumstance. This is our byline for version two. How does empathy help you become empowered despite circumstance?
Mm-hmm. I think if you look at the circumstances that you have challenges with and that you're seeking to have less challenge with, that you're seeking to feel empowered in response to, most of them have to do with other people and other people's perspective, wants. And so you're having a, you know, most of us are having a challenge with what somebody thinks of us or someone not wanting to go along with us on something we want. Or, and you imagine if you take all the people out of the world and you've got the rest of the world but with no people in it, there's most of the blocks that you had felt to what you want are gone, but also everything you want is gone, or the vast majority of it is. And so when we talk about empowered despite circumstance, a lot of it is how to relate to other people more effectively and how to relate with more empowerment regardless of where they're at, and when where they're at isn't exactly where we'd want them to be, right? And so what empathy does that empowers you despite circumstance with regard to other people is when you can really get where someone else is coming from, then the story you made up about they're just doing this to hurt me and, you know, they're nasty and life's unfair and all of that story is being stuck in your own perspective. And when you can take their perspective, take other perspectives, that story drops. And the negative perspective and judgments on that person drop. Even if you don't condone what they're doing, even if you think that it's based on misinformation or some of their own wounding, okay, so it's based on misinformation and their wounding. I can still empathize with that. And even if I'm going to work to stop it, it doesn't bother me in the same way anymore. And so when I really can get where someone else is coming from, I can accept things as they are radically more and be less bothered by them. And at the same time, I'm more effective. I have more capacity to help change things for other people, because when I really get, hey, they're only behaving that way because they're trying to meet a need and they don't know a better way to meet that need. And when I really felt into them, I can kind of feel what they need. I can feel what they're going for and I can care about it. I can want it. I can align with it. Now, rather than being in a fight with this person, I can be an ally and I can say, hey, what I get is that you're really caring about such and such. I care about that too. Can I help you with it? And so empathy gives us the ability to accept things as they are better and the ability to change them better simultaneously.
Well said. So in conclusion, we've learned several things today. We've learned how empathy is full spectrum. You know, it's not just emotional muscle, it's cognitive muscle, it's the ability to be able to relate with people. Also, there's empathy for yourself, there's empathy for others, there's empathy for the planet. Yeah. And so there's this broad range of capacity within this conversation called empathy. And it helps us in connecting with people. As you said, a lot of the reasons we're disempowered is because of conflict with others. And so with empathy, that is one of those core tools to help us better interrelate.
Yeah.
It's also, as you mentioned, one of the core tools to get clear on what drives us, what's that sense of purpose, right? What's going to ignite us with passion? You know, that secret sauce of the Gandhis and Nelson Mandelas of the world who have really changed things, is that tuning in to really what you want to do, what you want to create in the world, is another thing that comes from this muscle called empathy.
Yeah.
And so this has been great. Thank you so much, Daniel. And we look forward to having you back and continuing to share all the great work that you do.
Thank you, Andrew. I appreciate it.